everyone, and welcome back. Today's video is a very special video, because in this video not only do I talk about scholarships and how I research scholarships in the US for undergraduate students, who how to find out scholarships in the US, what they mean, different terminologies you should know, getting full ride scholarships, blah blah blah. Not only do I talk about those, this video is also a college review, because many of you have been asking me what university I'm going to, and now you're going to find out, because in the video I indirectly mentioned it. So if you guessed right, congratulations. But yes, I am going to the college that I mentioned in this video. All right, that's all for now. Thank you guys for sticking with me on this channel.
Hey, where's the drums?
Like I said, I'm talking to you about financial aid, about financing your studies, understanding what financial aid generally means. And I've heard that you guys have lots of questions, so don't worry, I'm going to answer as many of them as possible. I was admitted to 17 US schools on full ride scholarships, but in total, I was admitted to 23 schools. And those include HYPSM. If you don't know what HYPSM means right now, you will during this presentation. Also includes Johns Hopkins, Duke, Brown, New York University in Abu Dhabi, and I eventually decided on MIT because that was my dream school, and a couple of other things. We're going to be talking about financial aid, like I said, types of aid, what you're eligible for as an international student, how you apply for the aid. I'll briefly talk about the different forms, then I'll define what a full ride scholarship means, not a full tuition, but a full ride, where you can look for financial aid, and then we'll do a practical session, like a walkthrough, to understand how to actually research financial aid. So I want to start with a backstory. Many of you guys may not know this, but Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Stanford, and MIT, they have this acronym called HYPSM. And in total, the five schools have a combined endowment of $140 billion, which is about 58.8 trillion naira. So these schools have a lot of money. Harvard itself has about $32 billion in endowments, and Harvard is like the richest school in the world. And you know, we're still here in Nigeria, struggling with recession, struggling with inflation, where pure water is now 20 naira, when you could be applying for these scholarships and getting their money. So the goal of this presentation is for you to leave knowing that when you're applying for financial aid, you want to take as much of their money as possible. Basically, you want to finance your studies and get a full scholarship. I want to also mention that I may ask some questions, so please pay attention. This is a very important session and you won't regret listening to everything that I say. So what is financial aid? That's a very good place to start. Many of you know financial aid as a scholarship. If you ask a layman on the street, they'll say financial aid is the equivalent of a scholarship. But financial aid really is help in form of money, of a particular category that's used to sustain your education throughout school. So the money that you're going to use to afford college, the money that schools can give to you to be able to pay to finance your studies. Who offers financial aid? Colleges and universities. This is the aid we're aiming for. So through institutional grants that are set aside for financial aid purposes, which is what many EducationUSA members and international students go for. So schools like Harvard, Yale, MIT, Stanford, they have an entire endowment set out for just giving students scholarships and grants and financial aid. Then we have private organizations like the Coca-Cola scholarship in America, which international students are not eligible for, and a couple more. You might have heard of the NNPC, which is a Nigerian scholarship. And then the US government also gives scholarships or gives financial aid. They give this to US citizens and permanent residents. So if you're not a citizen, not a permanent resident, just forget US government money. We're targeting colleges and universities. Things you should know about financial aid is that every school has a different policy. And I'll explain this more as we proceed, but the competition for funding is really high, especially as an international student. So it's difficult to get a full scholarship. It's much easier to get partial funding, to get 50%, 70%, full tuition, but not full ride. And you really need to plan your finances early. So as we're finishing this bootcamp, you need to start talking to your parents about your process of applying to financial aid, which will make more sense by the end of today. Then the different types of financial aid. If I'm going too fast, please just say so in the chat and I'll slow down. These are important terms that you should know. And by the end of the bootcamp, you will have access to these slides in case you're not able to note them down. But one is scholarships. So that's the one we all know. Scholarships are everything that falls under the category of scholarships basically just means things that you're not paying back. You are awarded these things based on merit. So if you do something exceptional in school, if you do something exceptional for your country, you merit scholarships. You get merit scholarships. Schools are awarded based on people who are outstanding. You also get, there are also grants. Grants are given based on your need, based on how much you can afford and can't afford. If you come from a very low income background.
Okay. Pardon? Some people are already typing it there. You can slow down a bit, please.
Oh, okay. I will slow down. Sorry. So grants basically just refer to everything that a school gives you based on your need, based on how much you can afford or can't afford. It's also commonly called a scholarship. But the difference between grants and scholarships, in for being very, very strict about their differences, scholarships are really just awarded on merits, and grants are awarded on need. So if you can only afford $10,000, a school will give you the remaining $50,000 if their entire school fees is $60,000. And that $50,000 is a grant. Then work study. Many financial aid packages that you will see include work studies. So on-campus jobs that allow students to earn money for their studies as part of their financial aid package. For many of my financial aid packages, I had a work study program. So basically you can work on a school's campus and then they pay you per hour, and you can work like 10 hours during the semester, 40 hours during the summer. And then you're earning money that you can use to finance your studies, to buy books, to buy toothpaste, to buy toiletries and all those things. And then loans, which we should all stay far away from as international students. As a student, really, loans refer to all the money that is borrowed. So money that you have to pay back over a period of time. And when you're paying back, there's more money added on top. So it's likely going to be paid back with interest after maybe you finish your 4 years of study. But today we're going to be focusing on grants and scholarship provided by institutions, not by the government or by private organizations. We're going to be focusing on these ones because these are the ones that you should target, like the majority of your application, financial aid application should target. Many, many terms today, and you can ask them, you can ask questions at the end if you don't understand any of them, but many financial aid terms that you should know and will become more familiar with as you go along your college application process. The first one is expected family contribution. And this is, like it's on my screen, an annual measure of your family's financial ability, which is used to determine how much grant money you'll be awarded. Grant, so how much money that the school is going to give you for free. Many schools calculate your expected family contribution in different ways. And when you're applying for financial aid, you actually tell the school how much you believe your family can afford. Can your family only afford $10 per year or $1,000 per year? That's per academic year. How much can you afford and how much can, basically how much your family can contribute. So that's your family's financial ability. Then your cost of attendance. This is the total value of your expenses before financial aid. So everything that you have to pay to go to school. Many people only think of tuition, but many people don't think about transportation, books and supplies, health insurance, room, feeding, board, where you're going to be living, how are you going to be eating, and miscellaneous expenses, like maybe having to do an emergency trip to the hospital and you have to pay for that, which is still under transportation, and even study abroad programs. So your cost of attendance includes your direct costs and indirect costs. Your direct costs are things you are paying to the school. You have to pay for tuition, for fees, for health insurance, for your feeding, for staying on campus if you're going to be living on campus. But then for indirect costs like books and supplies, transportation, you cover those yourself, or if you get really good financial aid, your school gives you enough money to cover those. But you're never paying indirect costs to the school. You're only paying for direct costs. So direct cost plus indirect cost equals cost of attendance. And for a school to calculate how much you really need, what they do is they take the entire cost of attendance and then they subtract your expected family contribution. So if on your CSS profile, which is an application you will fill to apply for financial aid, you say that your family can only afford $1,000 per year and the entire sum of the school fees is $77,000. What the school will do is they will subtract your expected family contribution from your cost of attendance to give your financial need. But take notes, if you say you need $1,000, they may not necessarily only subtract $1,000. They may say, well, after we've gone through your family's income statements, your bank statements, we feel like you can actually afford $2,000. So you may end up having to, they may end up only covering the 75 out of 77, and then you're left with $2,000 instead of $1,000. I hope that made sense. But that's how financial aid is calculated. It's the entire cost of attendance, direct plus indirect costs, minus your expected family contribution, which the school calculates on their own based on what you say you can contribute and based on what they think you can actually contribute. Other notable financial aid terms, sticker price and net price. Now, sticker price is the intimidating thing you see on schools' websites or on their brochures. You see that to go to Harvard, you have to buy a kidney, an arm, a leg. You have to pay $78,000 per year. And I don't know where people would get that kind of money, because that's a lot of money. But sticker price is intimidating, meaning that it's not the actual thing that you might end up paying. Your net price is what you will actually pay. Your net price is your sticker price minus the financial aid or the scholarship, the grant, the work study, the loans that you receive from the school. So that's what you're actually going to pay to attend. If your net price is $0, it means that you have a full ride scholarship. So you're not paying anything. Many people pay $0 to go to Harvard. Many. I got my Harvard financial aid scholarship, like almost all my financial aid packages had a $0 net cost. Even though some of them had a work study, I wasn't paying any money to the school. I just had to like work to finance my studies. And that money that I was working for was to pay for like my books, not for my housing or anything. But we'll still analyze a typical financial aid package. And sometimes the net price can be a negative number. So meaning that like you have a surplus of money, money that covers more than $78,000. You might have $80,000 worth of a scholarship and you now have $2,000 to spare just to flex because you have like extra money, and your net price basically boils down to that. So don't be intimidated by a sticker price when you haven't received your financial aid. This is a better visualizer. So you can see that your net price is your sticker price minus gift aid, tax benefits, free money basically. The sticker price might be $9,000, but what you end up paying is $3,980, which is a lot less because you've subtracted your aid. So financial aid forms, I'm not really going to go deep into this because I saw that on the schedule, there's an entire presentation about these forms, but there are four basic forms. There may be more because different schools have like school specific forms, but the general ones and these are the general ones. The most popular one is the CSS profile. The CSS profile stands for College Scholarship Service, and it is by College Board. College Board is the body or the organization that handles the SAT. They also handle the CSS profile, so financial aid distribution. It's an online form. Then the ISFA is an alternative paper form to the CSS profile, which stands for International Students Financial Aid Application. It's only applicable to international students, and you can submit it if you can't pay the price of a CSS profile. I submitted my ISPA to Tufts, to Stanford, to Yale, and they all accepted it, to Johns Hopkins, and they all accepted it and gave me my financial aid package. The FAFSA, which we're also going to see a presentation on, is for US citizens. So you don't really need to bother about that unless you're a citizen. If you are, Francis is going to do a presentation on FAFSA. Then the ISCA, which is the International Student Certification of Finances, is a form similar to the ISFA. The ISFA shows your financial need, but the ISCA shows your financial ability. So you use the ISCA to certify the amount of finances that you have. The ISFA shows the amount of money that you need. But they kind of like go hand in hand. Again, if you don't understand everything I just said here, please wait to the presentation after my presentation because they will explain it in a much better detail. But these are just like, this is just like a surface introduction to the financial aid forms. Now let's analyze a typical financial aid package. This is a merit scholarship package, not a need. So it's a merit scholarship. It's not a grant-based, need-based package. If you don't understand the difference, I'm still going to explain them as we go along. But this was the merit scholarship I got from Washington and Lee University for the Johnson Scholarship. As you can see, this right here is my net price, which is $0, meaning it's a full ride scholarship. Then here, this is the grant, this is the scholarship, this is the merit scholarship I got from Washington and Lee University. And they covered every single thing. So they covered everything, because you can see my net price is $0. They didn't use my need to calculate it, they used my merit. So they compared me to other students and believed that I was outstanding to an extent. And then they gave me the merit scholarship. Right here, you can see the sticker price. So this is the price that they would say you need to pay to come. But my price ended up being, my net price ended up being $0, because once you subtracted my scholarship from my sticker price, I had $0 left to pay. Now, this is a need-based grant package. This was my Stanford University financial aid package. This was entirely based on need. Stanford does not give merit scholarships because everybody that gets into Stanford is already amazing. So you can see here, these are my direct costs, which we talked about, and then my indirect costs. Here we see the total cost of attendance, which is also the sticker price. So that's total of direct and indirect. I'm not going to pay indirect to Stanford. They just put it there as an estimate. Some students even end up paying less than this to for their indirect costs, because they have like very tight and optimal budgets. Then here, you can see the total grants and scholarship that Stanford gave me based on need. So all of this is need-based. It's not based on my merits. It's just based on how much my family could afford and couldn't afford. And you can see my expected family contribution, that's the EFC, is $0. So I wasn't going to pay anything directly to Stanford, but there's still a net price of $3,500. Now this net price is not something I was going to pay to Stanford. This net price is something I would use work study to cover. So I would earn a minimum of $3,500 per year. And all the money I'll be earning will be going straight to my bank account, and I can use it to take the bus, use it to buy really good food, California food, and those kind of things. I hope that made sense. Now, I want you to note that merit scholarships do not include work study. And for merit scholarships, you don't have to reapply for financial aid. But for need-based scholarships, there's usually a minor work study. I think almost all my need-based packages, except for Washington University in St. Louis, they had work study. And WashU, that's Washington University in St. Louis, didn't have a work study because they waived it because of the coronavirus. So in a normal year, they would have had a work study. And work studies are totally fine. Work study is still a full ride because you're still not paying anything to the school. You're just working, and the jobs are usually fun, like desk jobs. And with need-based scholarships, you have to reapply every year, which you'll hear more about during the next presentation. So you're reapplying for financial aid every year, and they estimate how much you need every year based on your parents' income, based on a couple of things, which I'll still talk about. But both of them still amount to a full ride, or can still amount to a full ride. Now, up next, we're going to be talking about how to research full funding opportunities. But at this point, I just want to stop to ask a question in the chat. Permit me to just stop sharing my screen for a second. Or no, I can still do it.
If you want, I can type the question for you.
Okay, yes, I wanted to ask, what is sticker price? I was trying to, I had like a poll, but I'm not seeing the link to the poll anymore. But I can just ask what a sticker price is. If you want to
go ahead and use the poll, if that's, you have it prepared.
So the poll is not loading. I don't know why. So I think it's better to just ask. Okay, I'm seeing responses in the chat. The amount, ooh, okay, you guys are coming in really fast. Whoa. So the actual amount of attending a school without financial aid, the amount put on the website but may not be the actual price paid to the school, very correct. What else? Is the actual cost of attending a school usually listed on the website? The amount that most schools list on their website, like this was off you. Okay, so you guys are actually following. I just wanted to be sure that like what I was saying was making sense. So yes, I'm glad that you understand the sticker price, and from some of your definitions, I can also see that you understand the net price and how that's different from the sticker price. So we're good. Okay, up next, we're going to be talking about researching full funding opportunities. now we know like, okay, we know basics of financial aid. We know like EFC, we know sticker price, we know net price, we know cost of attendance. We know the difference between a merit scholarship and a need-based grant. We know work study, we know loans. But now how do you actually get full rides? How do you go about researching them, applying, not applying for them, that'll be in the next session. How do you go about researching them? First, I'd like to state a few things about financial aid. As an international student, and I've said this before, you need to stay away from loans. You don't want to be having money owing back to a school, especially when you're not a US citizen. So stay clear. Advisors, EducationUSA advisors will even advise you not to go for any packages that include loans. Different schools will give you different aid packages, even with the same expected family contribution. With the same, if you use the same annual income, assets, annual expenses to apply, different schools will still give you different things. Like I applied to many schools, some gave me full scholarships and some didn't, but I used the same application for all of them. That's because different schools look at it differently. So like Harvard uses family income below $65,000. So if your family is not earning more than $65,000 per year, you're not paying a single dime to go to Harvard. Then for MIT uses $90,000 per annum. So if your family income is below $90,000, you're not paying anything in tuition. I didn't find the actual value for full ride at MIT, but for tuition, you're not paying anything in tuition if your family income is less than $90,000 at MIT. Every financial aid office, that's FAO, has a different formula. So they have their own formulas. This video is like 1 minute long, and I think we'll explain things a bit better if you didn't understand what I just said. And it is by Dylan Nellis, which is a YouTuber I watched a lot who goes to Stanford when I was applying. And during the session on essay writing, you'll see many YouTubers that I recommend that you guys can watch. But I think you can just listen to this video briefly.
And I'm going to be talking about the money that different schools are willing to give, the prestigious schools versus the not prestigious schools. So for top-ranked colleges, the ones that are considered prestigious, the ones that are considered elite, these schools give financial aid largely based on need and not merit. This is because they already have so many students who they admit who can pay the full price, and they just have a lot of money. Plus, because it is a brand new school, there is a higher chance that a student who is admitted will end up committing to their school. So pretty much all your financial aid is need-based. Out of all these prestigious schools, only 7% of the financial aid is merit-based. So it is important to understand that these schools that have need-based aid do have cutoffs. For example, let's talk about what it is at Stanford. As of 2021, if your annual household income is less than $150,000, your tuition is free. And if your annual household income is below $75,000, your tuition is free and your room and board is free. This is something that I really want to make known to the low-income students who are watching this video.
Okay, so I hope that explained things. So one thing she talked about were different cutoffs, which I've mentioned for Harvard, MIT, and she mentioned for Stanford. And then she mentioned merit-based, need-based. So that's something we really need to establish. We talked about merit scholarships, need-based grants, but what really is the difference between the two? So merit-based is based on your personal achievements in school, in arts, in athletics, in music. It can be anything, really. There are merit scholarships for everything. There's a merit scholarship for, there was like a merit scholarship for, I think, doing like a scientific experiment. There's a merit scholarship for people who can make hair. The merit scholarship for people who are interested in aerospace engineering and astronomy and so many things. Then for merit-based, only some schools have merit-based scholarships, and most of them require an additional application with more essays, which is really stressful. Now, need-based scholarships are based on how much your family can afford. So your family's inability or ability to pay the full cost of attendance. All schools have this, but not all schools meet full need. Now, full need means 100% of your need. Some schools can only meet partial needs. So if you need $80,000, that's like everything. Some schools will meet you there. Like Harvard will give you the entire bucket load of money. But some schools, like maybe the University of Miami, would only give you like 50%, they can only be 50% of your need because they're not really rich. You know, they don't have $140 billion in endowment. And for need-based, you apply using your CSS profile or ISFA and or ISCOP, which are the financial aid forms. You really don't have to write more essays for need-based grants. Two other terms are need-blind admissions and need-aware admissions. So need-blind admissions are very few schools that practice need-blind admissions, which is the policy of admitting you without considering your finances. Need-aware admissions are a lot for international students. So what this basically means, a school, when you apply for admission, it's different from when you're applying for financial aid. For some schools, your application for admission is really dependent on whether you can afford to come or not, which is kind of unfair. So if you can only afford $5,000, you might be a super strong applicant, but they'll deny you because you can't afford to come. But for need, that's like need-aware admissions. But for need-blind admissions, which schools like Harvard, Princeton, MIT, blah, 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 practice, they don't care how much you can afford. If you can't afford anything at all, they will admit you solely based on who you are as an applicant, solely based on your application and not based on your financial aid. So it's a bit tricky with financial aid, but you don't need to be afraid of need-aware admissions. Almost all the schools I go into on full-ride scholarships were need-aware. So they still admit students, even if they operate need-aware admissions. If you can't afford anything, they do. But it's so competitive and it's harder to get in. And they will only take you if you are a very, very, very strong applicant. Like during my Washington University in St. Louis merit scholarship interview, I was the only international student that was chosen for that merit scholarship. And they told me that we did not plan to admit any international students this year because many of them can't afford to come. But when we read your application, we really wanted you. And that's why we're saying that we can't risk financing your study. We can't risk giving you the scholarship. We can't risk like having you come because you are so strong. So you really have to stand out in the crowd. These are some good resources. I'm not really going to go through them because you can take a screenshot. You have access to the slides. These are very good resources that you can use to research financial aid in your own time. Sherry, can you mute yourself? Whoever that is. One of the co-hosts talking is distracting. But Google is definitely the best resource, in my opinion. Hands down, we can find everything on Google, and you see that when we do a walkthrough. You can also check the college's websites. You can use us. You can use EducationUSA alums and your EducationUSA advisors. They can tell you, like, they can give you tips on which schools to apply to. Reddit has this channel. Please download Reddit if you won't get distracted on it. But they have an applying to college channel. So many resources on there. Then Prep Scholar Prep Scholar is amazing. Prep Scholar is like my G during all my applications because I use it for my SAT, I use it for scholarships. And this specific link will probably change your life because it has so many merit scholarships, and all the merit scholarships that I got, I found on this link. So I'm making the work easier for you. Thank me later. But this link has like so many scholarships that you should definitely check out. Then if you're using some of these resources, you need to set your preferences for the mailing list. So on these different websites, you can subscribe to their mailing lists, but make sure that you're subscribing so that you're receiving notifications that match your interests. You shouldn't subscribe randomly and be receiving Italian scholarship for postgraduate studies. You have to set your preferences to receive scholarship updates for undergraduate students applying for North American scholarships. So things like Opportunity Desk, After School Africa, you can specify how you want to receive emails, what kind of scholarships you want to receive. So tips for, I can't see the title on this slide because the Zoom thing is covering it. So.
Tips for researching aid effectively.
Okay, thank you, Suzy. Tips for researching aid effectively. Like I said, don't be afraid of need-aware because students who apply to them still get in. Then scrutinize every detail of the scholarship. If you're not eligible, just don't even bother. If the minute you see US citizen, run away, close the tab. Don't get lost in the amount of benefits that that scholarship has because you're not going to get it anyway. Then use your college list as a guide if you have one, and then trim as you go based on your findings. There were some schools I started out with on my college list that I didn't apply to because I realized that they don't meet full need. Be a power searcher. Regularly check for different resources for opportunities and organize your findings in a very orderly manner. Then repeat. Almost everything here you will see in the next couple of slides in action. Like I said, if you're not eligible, please don't waste your time. I did that because I thought it was unfair that, oh my gosh, US citizens are eligible, but I'm not. But there are opportunities for international students, so just jump and pass. Okay, so this is a case study. We are Kunle, everybody here is Kunle, and Kunle is looking for scholarships. He just recently graduated from secondary school, which almost all of us here have. And he's looking for a school that can offer him enough funding in the US. So he wants a full ride. He doesn't really have any region or setting in mind. How can he create his college list to include offers of generous funding? A tip is you shouldn't only aim for merit scholarships. You can actually only apply to need-based schools, but try to have a mix of the two, or only have need-based scholarships because merits are very competitive, but don't only apply to merit scholarships. That's risky. The first thing Kunle should do is just do a generic search about colleges that offer full rides. Like I said, Google is the best tool ever. You should just Google US colleges that offer full rides to international students. And then you come across this prep scholar link, AKA the link that changed my life, that has a bunch of full ride scholarships. So let's check it out. So we're checking this link and we look through the scholarship opportunities here. We see the trustee scholarship, which covers full tuition. And it says that international students are eligible, okay. But then we also see the Jefferson Scholarship by University of Virginia, which covers full tuition, your fees, room and board, books, it's everything, it's a full ride. Which one are we going to choose? I don't know if you guys want to answer, there's really no time, but we would pick the Jefferson Scholarship because unless you can afford to pay like $12,000, which is your room and board and everything, just go for the one that has a full ride. Full tuition is not the same thing as full ride. So we'll go for the Jefferson Scholarship. Let's check out what's the Jefferson Scholarship about. So we go to the Jefferson Scholarship website and we see here the nominations for the Jefferson Scholarship pour in from all corners of the country and the globe, meaning that international students are eligible. So you have to confirm that you're eligible for that scholarship because there are many, many merit scholarships for Americans, but not for international students. So we see that, okay, we can apply for this. So let's keep going. We now see that nominations, want to see the requirements. What do we need to do to actually apply? The nominations have to be completed by the school officials and students, okay, both of them. And the Office of Undergraduate Admission and the Scholars Foundation are different. So the scholarship, the merit scholarship reviewers don't have access to your admission, your application to the school itself. So they don't have access to your Common App. Remember I said that merit scholarships should have an extra application. So this states that your Common App is going to be completely separate from your merit scholarship application and they don't overlap at all. So you want to make sure that your merit scholarship is also showcasing the strengths you showcase in your Common App. Then we see, okay, the deadline is December 1st. So we have to get everything in by December 1st, not by January 1st, not by the regular decision deadline, but by December 1st. Like I said already, this indirectly tells us to add UVA to our Common App. So if you're applying for the Jefferson Scholarship, don't make the mistake of forgetting to apply to the University of Virginia itself on the Common App. Then you can email and check the FAQs for any other questions you have. Merit scholarships require a separate application from the Common App. They require an additional essay, or they can be given by automatic consideration. I got a merit scholarship from Johns Hopkins and I didn't apply for it. I just got it. It wasn't a full merit scholarship. It was just, it covered parts of the fees and the rest was need-based. So merit scholarships and need-based grants can go hand in hand, can be combined to give you a full ride. And you can usually find the application for merit scholarship on a separate portal, or you can find it on the Common App itself. There'll be a space for that, like the Johnson Scholarship from Washington and Lee. After this, we want to document our findings. So you don't want to keep everything in your head. You forget, we're human beings, it's okay. But make sure you document everything that you find. Okay, we know that University of Virginia offers this full ride merit scholarship and you have to be nominated by your high school and sending your main application by January 2nd, that's your Common App. But the scholarship application deadline itself is December 1st. And yes, there is an additional application required. But we have gotten a merit scholarship now, but we need to have it even out. We don't just want merit scholarships. Let's look for a need-based scholarship as well. So I just checked my time. Okay, I still have time. So now we're heading back to Google. And now we want
Are you in your second presentation?
Yes, it's 2-in-1.
Okay.
So this is already the second part. Okay, so now we're researching schools in the US that meet full need for international students. Because remember what I said about trying to have a combination of merit and need or just need. So we're going back to Google, the best research source for financial aid, and we're typing this. And instantly, Google doesn't waste time. Google gives us 14 US colleges that offer generous financial aid for international students. Only 14, but trust me, there are much more than this. So we're going to click on this link, and this link takes us to the common. We see, okay, Princeton, MIT, Amherst, Williams, Caltech. So these schools meet 100% of demonstrated financial need, not 50, 100%. Some of them are need aware, but don't be afraid of need aware. We already know Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Stanford, MIT. We know HIPSM is generous. So let's check out this college, Williams College. So we just Google Williams College financial aid. We want to know more about this Williams College that gives 100% need. And we see additional information for international applicants. International applicants seeking financial assistance. William offers one of the most generous and comprehensive financial aid programs in the US. Are you sure? We need to confirm. While the college isn't need blind, nearly 60% of our international students still receive financial aid. So we go to the website, we see right here, smack in the middle, Williams meets 100% of every student's demonstrated need. And for international students, it doesn't say anything about international students, but we see that the FAFSA, which is for US citizens, does not apply to us, so we skip that. And then we see that the CSS profile is required for any student who wants to be considered for non-federal aid, so aid from that school. The application deadline for regular decision is January 15th for the financial aid application, not for the admission application. We document our findings again. So now we have a merit scholarship, we have a need-based scholarship, and our college list is being built up. We're doing pretty good. So Williams College has full need-based scholarships. You submit the CSS profile and supporting documents like your family's income statement, bank statement, blah, blah, blah. There's no additional application. We didn't see anything about a merit scholarship that Williams have, but there might be. We didn't research it. And we see the scholarship app deadline. Oops, this was supposed to say January 15th, not January 2nd, because remember, we saw January 15th. So yeah, that's how to research scholarships. I hope that was helpful, but you can do so much more. You can go further. That was like me doing the bare minimum, but you can be a power searcher and subscribe to mailing lists. These are a couple of merit scholarships that I've listed out on these slides that you can check out. Also making the work easier for you. These are not the only ones though. There are lots and lots and lots. But these are some that I applied to and I was successful with four of these, but these three, I didn't get the Handler, I didn't apply for the presidential, I didn't get the Woodruff. So there's some schools I applied to that didn't give me scholarship, but that doesn't mean they won't give it to you. These are also a couple more. I'm not going to go through them one by one, they're just here for your reference. Don't feel pressurized to apply to too many. They are a lot of work and are very competitive, but they're just here in case you want to check them out. Then these are some schools that meet your full need without any loans. Please, in your free time, you can Google them, but there's so many more. Don't be limited to these. This is just me helping you out with the college research. We're almost done, but apart from all these, not everybody gets a full ride scholarship. That's the reality of things, but there are other options. There are tuition-free colleges. Some schools give you tuition for free and all you're paying is your room and board, and that might only amount to like $5,000. So those are things you can consider. Then there are women's colleges, which have really good financial aid. There's off-campus housing. You don't have to pay to stay on campus because on-campus housing is usually very expensive, but you can live off-campus. There are community colleges, which are much more affordable. So after 2 years in a community college, you can transfer to a regular college and save money. Then you can apply to HBCUs, which are much, much more affordable than like HYPSM. And you can also apply to schools outside of Nigeria and the US. I'm not going to say too much about that because this is EducationUSA, but have a backup plan. Don't just put all your eggs in one basket. I applied to many, many schools. Thank you for listening. I'll be happy to take questions now, and I'm so glad. I have like 6 minutes left. I don't think I'll finish on time. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, Victory. That was excellent.
Bye. Catch you later. One of a kind, living in a world gone plastic. Baby, you're so classic. So cool.